before the presenter comes up, I've invited a very special guest to kick off tonight's event. And this is a longtime friend of the museum and also a magician. So you're in for a treat. Please join me in welcoming Mark Mitton.
Thank you, Cindy. Thanks for everybody for coming to MoMath tonight. And I'm really excited here to present Bob Hearn, who I first met in 2002 at a meeting of the Gathering for Gardner. Now, as you know, MoMath next summer is going to have a big recreational math conference called MOVES, which is really exciting, and people should show up for that. But for a long time now, down in Atlanta, every other year, there's been a celebration of Martin Gardner's and people that loved his writing. So it tends to pull mathematicians, puzzle experts, and magicians, and because Martin was amazing at all of them. So I'm going to first do a little stunt, and then I'm going to tell you all about Bob. It's very exciting to be here for him. You're going to learn to look at a Rubik's Cube in a completely new way by listening to Bob's talk. So that's why I'm featuring this. And we've got a young man right here. What is your name, sir?
Otto.
Okay. Otto, what I'd like you to do, could you name one of the colors of the Rubik's Cube?
White.
Okay. What I'm going to try to do, if I can, is behind my head. I hope this works. Just for Otto, I'm going to try to fix this thing. And, oh, man, I don't know if it... Oh, yes, it did work, because if you look on the backside, there it is, just for you. And thank you. You're very kind. Now, the hard part is, if we can... Oh, I'm going to try... This is the hard part, the behind-the-head solve. There it is.
Wow.
Thank you. Thank you. Now, I want to teach you a way that you can do this. Otto, can you point to some adult in your area? Some adult, anywhere you want, just some random adult. Oh, perfect. And what is your name?
Kathleen.
Could you mix that all up? Just mix it up quickly.
Sure.
And then, yeah, and if, yep, all right. So as Kathleen, I'm going to teach you all the way so that you can solve a Rubik's Cube instantly. Okay? So okay. Kathleen has got it right next to Otto. Otto, are you happy? Do you want to give it a couple turns? Just fast. Okay, there's Tim holding a mic on Otto to make sure he's catching the sound. Okay, that's excellent. Now there's a twisting cube. Okay, don't overdo it, because, all right, let's see if we can do this. All right, I'm going to try if I can. I'm going to take the cube, mixed by Kathleen and Otto. I'm going to try to just shake it up in the bag instantly. There it is. Thank you. Thanks, everybody. Thank you. Thank you. It's very something. I know what you're thinking. Could you hold out a second? Thank you. Okay, because, okay, there's a secret, right? Because you have to have an extra cube. And then, of course, you can do it by just switching them in the bag. And but the hard part, if I can, we're going to try this. Could you hold this up, sir? Just hold it up just like this. Okay, wait. Okay, I'm going to try if I can. Okay? Wish me luck. Okay, thank you. Okay, I'm going to try if I can. Up. Oh. This is an event in racing speed cubing called the rescramble, and if I did it, okay, good. That was lucky. There it is.
Wow.
Thank you. Thank you. Like there, every single side. We're going slowly, the top and the bottom. There it is. Let's hear it for Otto and Kathleen. Yeah. Now, without further ado, I'm going to tell you all about Bob Hearn, because here's what's funny. We've literally worked so hard. He works on the program. I work on the entertainment at G4G. Even though I've known him since 2002, I didn't know anything about him, and he is extraordinary. I actually took the time to write this down. Usually, as you can tell, I just speak because I get so excited, but I wrote a bunch down because I've got too much to say quickly. So Bob grows up in Tulsa, Oklahoma. He receives from his, I assume your parents, an Apple II in 1977, and then he distinguishes himself in all these computer programming contests. And then there's an amazing clip. You should look. It's amazing. Of him performing the Rubik's Cube on television when he's just a little high school guy. He solves it in 1 minute and 8 seconds. But the most beautiful thing was explaining the method to a local reporter. He casually uses the term algorithm. And the reporter's like, what? And then, like it's nothing, he explains it in one phrase and just moves on. It's amazing. Anyway. So then from that illustrious high school career, he goes to study computer science at Rice University. After that, he starts working at a company called Styleware in Houston, which made software for the Apple II computers, full circle. And now, Styleware moves to the Bay Area when it's acquired by Claris, which is a subsidiary of Apple.
And Bob and a colleague, they worked there for a while, but they're updating, they're like fixing old programs, and they're not inventing new programs. They move away to start their own software company, and they faced all these struggles and adventures. You can read about it online. Guy Kawasaki brings them into his office, and it's an amazing story. Then they come up with this amazing product that then is acquired by Claris. And then it's called ClarisWorks, and then it gets redubbed AppleWorks, which is something that people our age all use. So it's amazing. And then, in his late 20s, Bob decides to go back for a PhD. He's intrigued by the AI work of Marvin Minsky, but he gets there, and he's also drawn to the complexity in games of a very young professor there named Eric DeMaine, who happens to be the very first speaker at Math Encounters that Cindy brought. So it's kind of all full circle. Thank you, Simons Foundation. It goes full circle. And Bob writes a book with his, this is his dissertation, done as a, it's a bit pricey, but it's a fantastic book. You can see it in the bookstore. And it's called Games, Puzzles, and Computation. It's co-written by Bob and Eric DeMaine. And so then, after that, he studies AI and neuroscience in a postdoc at Dartmouth. And he works, he creates a couple startups, as he says, like it's nothing, keeps working on his ideas. But then at 38, he decides to start running. And running he does, because with the same kind of precision that he's done everything else in his life, he moves into ultra marathon circles. And so, and in the, Sarah can confirm this, that in ultra marathon circles, he is known as the Prince of Pacing. And you can tell, look at his watch later if you can get close enough. It's amazing. And he carefully calculates all of his moves, all of his energy. It's extraordinary. So, and he does things like he'll run 143 miles in 24 hours. So just, we have a lot to learn from Bob. Today, he's going to redefine the way you look at a Rubik's Cube. Keep thinking about that idea. And so, it's a big adventure into the whole world of symmetries in a new whole way. So please join me in welcoming me and everyone else, all of you, to Mo Math's Math Encounters, the one and only Bob Hearn.
Thank you, Mark. It's a real honor to be here. I want to thank Cindy and thank Mo Math for inviting me, giving this venue to share some of these cool things that a bunch of us have discovered. And I'm especially honored to be introduced by no less than Mark Mitton. You all got a real treat there. Thank you, Mark. Actually, before I begin, apparently everybody has an iPad, right? You were handed when you came in. That's sort of for the hands-on thing at the end of the talk. So if you can, if you play with it now, you'll understand it better at the end of the talk. And I'll be able to step through and give you a demo of everything. But all right, so this is a talk about symmetry. And symmetry is, as you might imagine, is extremely foundational and important to many areas of, not just of mathematics, but in physics, for example. The symmetries of space and time relate to things like the conservation of momentum and the conservation of energy. If you look at particle physics, like the strong nuclear force is connected to the symmetry group SU3. Symmetries are everywhere. In art, obviously, symmetry is foundational. You could make the argument that beauty is all about subtleties in the differences in kinds of symmetries. So it's really exciting to me to be able to share what I think of as new ideas in the space of symmetry, because symmetry, honestly, in the world of math has been mined pretty thoroughly. So before I get to the nitty-gritty, I do want to thank several people. My current collaborators are in bold there, Will Kretschmer, Tom Rokicki, Ben Streeter, and Eric Virgo. Eric is here in the audience as well today, and several other people have contributed to some of these ideas over the last several years. Okay, so compound symmetry. What is compound symmetry? I'm going to skip ahead to the punchline a little bit and show some pretty pictures, and then I'll cycle back and explain where these came from and why they're interesting. So here is one that you might notice there's some regions of five-fold symmetry, there's three-fold symmetry, the big flower things have 15-fold symmetry. These are not symmetries that you ordinarily see in math art. There's no way to extend these symmetries to the entire plane. Those are forbidden symmetries, and I'll talk a lot more about that. Here is one that's based on ninefold symmetry, something you never see. The software tool here that creates these things you can think of as a weird new kind of kaleidoscope. There's regions here of threefold symmetry. Overall, it looks like it mostly has ninefold symmetry, but that's broken on the largest scale. This one comes from fivefold symmetry. There's regions of tenfold symmetry. All of these things are sort of, you can say, well, that's a piece of math art. You know, you might ask Dolly to say, make me some math art or something, and it might look like that. But these are actual places in a mathematical landscape that has simply not been looked at before. They're not just, you know, made up things. They're places that are characterized by a very small number of parameters that you could go and type into a program and go there and explore. And I'll explain all of that. This one comes from a combination of five-fold and four-fold symmetries. There's 10-fold and 20-fold in there. That's also the pattern I have on my shirt here. And okay, so that's sort of the landscape that we're going to be exploring. And so let me explain now what I mean by a compound symmetry group. And this talk is not going to be heavy on group theory. You don't have to know anything about group theory, but I do need to define what I mean by symmetry group so that I can distinguish a compound symmetry group from the more basic geometric classical symmetry groups. So the standard definition is that the symmetry group of a shape or pattern is the set of isometries that leave it unchanged. And isometry just means transformation that is distance preserving, like a rotation, reflection, those are isometries. Scaling is not an isometry. So an example would be, if we look at the regular pentagon, rotation by 72 degrees, that is an isometry. Another one would be reflection about one of the axes of symmetry. And it turns out that those two symmetries combined can generate any of the symmetries. You can rotate, reflect, and you can reach any of the possible isometries that apply to the pentagon, and together those constitute the symmetry group of the regular pentagon. If we want to look at and that's known algebraically as the dihedral group D5. All these groups have names and all sorts of things known about them. Here's a repeating pattern in the plane, and this is one of what are called the wallpaper groups because it's repeating patterns. And this is the crystallographic name for this is P4, but I prefer the orbifold notation in which it's called 442 because that actually makes sense. You can see that there's one twofold rotation of symmetry, and there's two kinds of centers of fourfold rotational symmetry. Basically, at the blue centers and the orange centers each have fourfold rotational symmetry. And if you combine that twofold and that fourfold and that fourfold rotation, that generates the entire group of symmetries, all the possible symmetries of this thing. Okay, so that's an example of the wallpaper groups. Now, symmetry groups, as you might imagine, have been studied for a very long time in mathematics, and the symmetry groups of a given kind have been characterized and tabulated. So, for example, the wallpaper groups, up to isomorphism, it turns out there's only 17 different kinds of them, only 17 different ways that you can combine symmetries in the plane to get a repeating pattern. If we look at a strip instead of the whole plane, so you might have like Greek key or something in this strip, those are called frieze groups. There's 7 of those. If we move up to 3D, the 3D analog of the wallpaper groups are the space groups. There's 230 of those. Those correspond, for example, to the ways that you can arrange atoms in a crystal lattice. So a very tight connection there between math and physics and the real world, because real materials, real crystals, have one of these 230 possible structures in their arrangements of atoms. Okay, but again, there's only so many ways to do this, and one of the relevant things is called the crystallographic restriction theorem, which leads to this notion of forbidden symmetries that's in the title. And that says that repeating patterns in the plane can only have 2, 3, 4, or 6-fold rotational symmetry. There's no such thing as a repeating pattern with 5-fold rotational symmetry or 7 or anything higher. You can't do that. And so those are forbidden symmetries. However, some of you might have heard of quasicrystals, which can kind of approximate those symmetries. Penrose tiles are related to quasicrystals. They're these patterns that don't have the strict symmetries that a crystal or a strict repeating pattern would have to have, but they have a lot of the same properties. And you can approximate fivefold symmetry with quasicrystals. In fact, the 2011 Nobel Prize in Chemistry was won for the discovery of icosahedrite, actually in nature. Quasicrystals exist in nature. All right, so that is our starting point, classical symmetry groups and the restrictions that are placed on them. And again, the symmetry group is the set of isometries that leave it unchanged. And you can again think of that as being generated by some smaller set of isometries that combine to generate all of the isometries. Now, those isometries operate on the entire ambient or embedding space of the shape. Like, if we look at the isometries of a pentagon, we are talking about rotations of the entire plane, reflections of the entire plane. What if we relax that restriction and we say, well, we're going to have a group generated by isometries, but those isometries are allowed to operate on different subspaces of a big metric space. And by allowing those different isometries to interact, we're going to be able to explore some of these classically forbidden symmetries in new ways. So that's all a compound symmetry group is. It's a group generated by a set of isometries that operate on different but overlapping metric spaces. And if that sounds confusing, let me make it more explicit. So here's a very trivial example. We've got two disks in the plane, and they each have five-fold symmetry. So we can say, well, what is the group generated by five-fold rotation of the left disk and five-fold rotation of the right disk? Well, it's not very interesting because they don't interact at all. This has the structure of what's called C5 cross C5, where C5 is the cyclic group with five elements. Okay, fine. But suppose we let them overlap. We can then define this compound symmetry group as the group generated by those two rotations. And now it's not quite so simple because when you turn one disk, it moves a piece of the other disk with it and breaks the plane into pieces in ways that ordinary symmetry groups don't. And that makes all the difference. So here we've added these nine extra sort of wedge-shaped pieces around the edge, and that adds in what's called the alternating group on nine elements because we get the even permutations of those. So this group structure is more complicated. But as we keep increasing the overlap, the symmetry requirement means that effectively there's many more tiny pieces that it chops the plane into to maintain the symmetry. And so what's going to happen here as we keep increasing the overlap? To be specific, let's say we center the left disk at -1, 0 and the right disk at +1, 0. Then this system is completely characterized by one number, the radius, and we're gradually increasing the radius. What's going to happen if we try to increase the radius and thus the overlap out to infinity? Well, it's not too hard to show that that's not going to work. We're not going to have a finite number of pieces like we do here, because the crystallographic restriction theorem basically says that if you have rotational symmetry about, you can't have five-fold rotational symmetry about two distinct points, which is what we have, because that will produce a lattice with five-fold symmetry, and we know that doesn't exist. So something interesting is going to happen as we increase the radius and we go from this well-defined finite case up to the case that we are told is impossible. And let's explore what that is. So here we have a small amount of overlap, and I am going to zoom in, play a movie and zoom in while I am also increasing the radius, and we'll watch what happens as new structure gets created. That's sort of where we just were. And then we sort of get these interfering waves that whenever waves cross, new structure is created, and it just grows, you know, exponentially as we get closer and closer and closer to what turns out to be a limit. This is one of my opening slides, and you can see now where it came from, directly from the overlapping of circles with five-fold rotational symmetry. And if we zoom back out at this point, this is what the whole space looks like. And turns out we are now right up against what we can call a critical radius, where things go from well-behaved to not well-behaved. In fact, at the critical radius, this group becomes infinite, And if we're thinking about the pieces that this is chopped into, they become infinitely tiny and made of fractal dust. So before I can describe that in detail, let me tell you a little bit about how this image was created. This is the orbit of the disk boundary points under the group generators. And what that means is, if we look at the disk boundaries and chop those into little tiny segments or points, and then for each point, we say, where can this point be under all any possible sequence of rotations, and map those out, that basically plots a set of curves in this space, and then that defines areas that we fill in with colors. So what we're looking at is the image of the boundaries under all possible move sequences, and that chops this thing into this set of pieces. But embedded within this is this fractal. And this fractal is, instead of the image of the entire boundary, it's the image of just one point on the boundary. But we do the same thing. Pick a point on the boundary and explore and plot all the possible places that point could land under any sequence of rotations, and we get this pattern. And this has this recursive fractal structure to it right at the critical radius. And that's the case for any n other than 2, 3, 4, or 6, because of the crystallographic restriction theorem. Any other n, there is a characteristic fractal right at a characteristic critical radius for that n. And these have never been seen before, which, when you think about that, is really crazy. This is a very simply defined family of fractals, like the Mandelbrot set or something, but nobody's ever looked at these spaces before. And possibly the reason for that is that, even though the definition is very simple, it takes a lot of computation to be able to create these images and explore the spaces in the way that we've been able to do in the last few years. So maybe it was just waiting for computers to get powerful enough. I don't know. But anyway, this is the n equals 5 fractal. It's a new mathematical object, and you'll see some of the others later in the talk. So on the mathematical front, we'll come back to the art front, but on the math front, there's some obvious questions that are raised here. Where do these fractals come from? What creates this recursive structure? Another really obvious one is, for any n, there is a critical radius at which, this is the n equals 5 case with five-fold symmetry. For n equals 7, there's a different critical radius, a different fractal. What determines, is there a formula for the critical radius? Can we figure that out? In general, the answer is not that we can tell. We have numerically evaluated the critical radius for all n up to 100, up to about 5 decimal places, which represents an enormous amount of computation. You can also vary n. You can say n on the left is 3 and n on the right is 5, and we have all those critical radii as well. For this particular case, n equals 5, we know exactly what the critical radius is, and I'll show you how that works. So just like this was embedded in the full image, embedded within here is a set of lines. And these lines are the image of a single boundary point, but instead of applying all possible rotation sequences, so the two generators of the left disk and the right disk, we're now using a single generator, which is called A prime B, meaning we turn the left disk counterclockwise and turn the right disk clockwise. That's our one step, and we're allowed to do that over and over and over. So we take one point in the boundary, and then it goes here, and then it goes here, and then it goes here, and it's just a linear sequence. It becomes a discrete dynamical system that we can start to investigate the properties of. And that system maps out this set of lines right at what we see as the critical radius. And conveniently, we can draw some pentagons in here and do some trigonometry, and that will let us determine exactly that this critical radius is the square root of phi plus 3, where phi is the golden mean. So it's always satisfying when you're doing something in math and the golden mean pops up. So we know exactly what the critical radius is for n equals 5. For most other n, we don't. We also can prove, most of what we've done is empirical numerical stuff. We run our software and we create these images and we say, wow, there's fractals, or wow, that goes infinite. That's not the same as proving that it's infinite. In this case, we can prove that right at this critical radius, this group is infinite. And the way that that works is as follows. If we pick some point in the middle line, say here, and we keep applying that single generator, it jumps around and around and around. It's not too hard to show that when it comes back to this middle line, it's been translated along that line by some amount that is irrational, compared to the length of the line. And that means that it can never repeat. And that's why actually why those lines get filled in densely. So we now have a proof that this group actually is infinite at the critical radius. So what happens when we go past the critical radius? The short answer is it gets very messy and everything gets filled up with fractal dust. But there's patterns in the dust, as you can see. And if we look here, this is the n equals 5 case, well past the critical radius. You can see some structure there. You can see these things that look like grid lines and nodes, and there's like pentagonal shapes. I mean, it sort of looks like a five-fold lattice. Such a thing doesn't exist. But what this is actually is it corresponds to a five-fold symmetric quasicrystal, just like icosahedrite. And so these parallel bars, if you look at the spacings of adjacent pairs of them, that's related to the golden mean. Those are called Amann bars, and they're well-known things. But it's very interesting to see them in these compound symmetry groups. And in fact, if we look at where those nodes are, we can use those as vertices to place Penrose tiles, which those of you who know what they are, hopefully your jaws are dropping, because Penrose tiles are these amazingly cool things that they tile the plane, but not in a periodic way. So there's two shapes here discovered by Roger Penrose, the kites and the darts, and you can use those to cover up the entire plane, but not in a way such that you're able to translate the plane so that the image lines up with itself. It's always going to be non-repeating. And so those things show up inside the n equals 5 compound symmetry group. In hindsight, this makes sense because we're in this regime of forbidden symmetry. But at the time that this was discovered, one of the guys who was working with me on this very early on said, you know, Bob, I wonder if these things are related to Penrose tiles. And I'm like, why in the world would we find Penrose tiles hiding inside these puzzles? Because this started with puzzles, and I'll get back to that. But sure enough, there they are. And no one was more surprised than I was. All right. So there is a bunch of theory of two-disc compound symmetry groups. Let's go back and look at some of this art again. So this is where we started. This is my first slide. I like this one so much. I printed it on canvas and hung it on my wall. It goes well with my Oaxacan alligator there. So this comes from this image here, which we can now recognize as a compound symmetry group where the left disc has threefold symmetry and the right disc has fivefold symmetry. And if you pick the left radius and the right radius just right, that completely defines and generates this pattern. So this is a space that we can surf around in and explore. And so the previous slide, this one, is the region in this middle left there where those three little red pentagons are just zoomed way in. So that's where that one comes from. The pattern on my shirt here comes from this 5 versus 4 compound symmetry group. And here I'm showing what my program interface looks like. This is my Mac software that I wrote to image these things, where I specify the N's and the R's and various rendering parameters. So here's what the whole space looks like at these particular values. You can see the right disk is a bit larger than the left to get the effect I was after. Zoom in, it looks like that. Zoom in again, there's where we are. And so that's sort of how the art is connected to the math explicitly. Let me go back now about 10 years and tell you where all of this originally came from. I mentioned puzzles. There's this online forum, the Twisty Puzzles forum, for enthusiasts of Rubik's Cube variants, basically. And there's also two-dimensional variants of Rubik's Cubes. And there's this particular one called Gizmo Gears. I have it here if anyone wants to play with it after the talk. So this is sort of like a 2D kind of Rubik's Cube. You have two possible turns you can make, and the pieces get permuted, as happens on a Rubik's Cube. The thing here is you can see that these pieces are not all the same shape. It's not a very regular thing. It sort of wants to turn in steps of 30 degrees. That's 1/12 of a turn. But it's what's called a bandaged puzzle. So if you, for example, if you turn the left one 30 degrees, the right one may not be able to turn. because it's bandaged. And that makes this a very challenging puzzle to solve, actually. But so the question arose on the forum, can we unbandage this puzzle? And if so, what would it look like? Unbandage meaning chop these pieces into smaller pieces so that any possible sequence of 30-degree moves is allowed. And everybody was sure that the answer was yes, that it would not be possible. This actually is a thing in twisty puzzles called jumbling. If there's a puzzle that cannot be finitely unbandaged, it's called jumbling. But only certain very rare 3D twisty puzzles had this property, and everybody was sure Gizmo Gears did not. Well, lo and behold, it does, because as it turns out, this is an example of the n equals 12 compound symmetry group that is just past the critical radius. And in hindsight, it sort of seems clear that because of the crystallographic restriction theorem, there has to be a critical radius, and there has to be something like this that you cannot unbandage. At the time, it shocked everybody when this was discovered. So let me mention now some of the other people who have contributed. Brandon Enright was one of the first people after me to get involved. He was actually responsible for that proof that the group is infinite at n equals 5 critical radius we saw earlier. Here's one of his images of n equals 12, again with a single generator, like we saw earlier. Brandon is also the one who discovered that in some cases single generators can generate infinite structure and you don't need to use two generators. This is a really interesting example because here we see snaking through n equals 12 this little like linear fractal snowflake thing, more blown up a little bit more. You can see it snaking through this central thing. And some of you might recognize that as very similar to the fractal known as the Koch snowflake. This is the Koch snowflake. And it's defined by a recursive rule that says you replace every little segment with a segment, smaller segment with a triangular bump. And you iterate that recursively, and that generates this snowflake-like structure based on these triangles. Well, this one looks similar. This is what the actual embedded curves looks like there in Brandon's image, except it looks like it's not quite triangular. It's more square or fourfold, but it's clearly in the same family as the Koch snowflake, and yet it's just hiding in this n equals 12 compound symmetry group. Jason Smith was another early person to write his own imaging software and explore this. It's kind of neat that there's probably, I don't know, more than a dozen different code bases people have written now, programs to image these things in different ways, and they all have different styles. Jason's images always look very biological to me. This looks like a cross-section through a cell showing different organelles or something like that. More recently, Eric Virgo got involved, and really I have Eric to thank for being here today, because Eric is a super talented mechanical engineer, worked at Apple, helped design this laptop, and a super talented puzzle designer. But about a year and a half ago, I guess, he just got extremely interested in this compound symmetry stuff, before it had the name compound symmetry, and quit his job at Apple and has worked on this full-time since, and is going to go back to grad school and be a mathematician now. So some of the things that he has explored are: what happens if you take a single generator like AB prime and you look at irrational turn angles? Now, you can't have a finite compound symmetry group with an irrational turn angle, but you can look at the images created by these single generators. So here, instead of n equals 5, we have n equals e. You turn by 2 pi over e, and that generates some really cool structure. Here is one where the turn angle is the golden mean, and there's a different generator. And Eric's done an awful lot of work here. Really, I think he has material for his own talk on the structure of these single generator images. He's also looked at how tilings can be generated from compound symmetry groups. Here is a very common tiling, many of you might have, one of the Archimedean tilings that happens to be embedded in this compound symmetry group. So Eric has done a lot, but I said I have him to thank for being here, because this work was started about 10 years ago. That's when that Gizmo Gears problem first appeared on the twisty puzzle forum. And I did a lot of work. A lot of other people did a lot of work. And whenever I thought it was time to publish something, someone would find a new loose end that had to be untangled. And Eric really re-injected a lot of energy into this effort and coalesced a group of us to actually sit down and write a paper and put things together and make it all more formalized. So thank you, Eric, for that. All right, let's look some more at the fractals and see if we can understand what this structure is. This is the n equals 12 fractal. So you can see the left disk and the right disk each have 12-fold symmetry. And the way that we define these fractals formally is it's the set of points that have an infinite image under those group generators. So these are all the points that have an infinite image. This fractal is probably the simplest in terms of its structure. As we zoom in, we can see where everything repeats and repeats with a very rapid time scale, and it just goes on and on and on. We still don't have a good theory of how these fractals come to be. You know, we saw with the snowflake curve, it's got this explicit scaling rule that says you replace this segment with a smaller one. That's the hallmark of a fractal, is the repeating of a geometric structure on smaller and smaller scales. But these groups are defined purely in terms of rotation. There's no scaling. So where does this scaling of structure come from? It's still pretty mysterious. We can understand a little bit about what the structure is if we don't understand where it comes from. Ben Streeter, also one of the current collaborators, has discovered that this is what the structure of the n equals 12 fractal is. You take two dodecagons, regular dodecagons, and put them together along an edge. Those are the big dodecagons in the middle. And then at each vertex, you put a smaller dodecagon scaled so that they also touch along their edges. And if you do that recursively for each of the smaller ones, that basically maps out where the holes are in the Swiss cheese of this n equals 12 fractal structure. And so now we understand the structure of it, at least. And using that definition of the fractal, Ben was able to also derive an exact value for the critical radius, which happens to match our numerical value very well. So that's great. N equals 7 is an even more interesting case. The n equals 7 fractal is a little bit strange. Ben also found a way to characterize its structure. You start with two 7-gons, but now at the vertices you put 14-gons instead of 17-gons. And then recursively at the borders of those 14-gons you put more heptagons, 7-gons, and you alternate the 14-gons and the heptagons all the way down. And that maps out to where the holes are in this structure. N equals 7 is a little bit more complicated. You can see there's parts that go outside and parts that are chopped off, but the basic structure is and the scaling relationships are captured by this. N equals 7 has a very confusing thing that I'm just about to show you. This was discovered by Tom Rokicki, one of the newest people to join our group. And we have Tom to thank for a lot of things, mostly for finding a much more efficient way to image these spaces than I was doing. I mentioned nobody's seen these fractals before because it takes some computational horsepower and understanding of the right way to compute these things. You know, to compute these images, basically, you know, you either plot points or plot boundary points or something, but however you do it, you're going to start with some point and say, what are all the possible places that this point could get under any rotation sequence? And the trick there is you have to know when to stop that search. If I rotate it this way, oh, I've already seen that one. You have to keep track of all the ones that you've already seen and compare against them. So that's not only slow, but it means you have to keep all those points in memory. Well, Tom came along and found a way around that, and that's maybe not too surprising. Some of you might know Tom as the person who first proved that God's number for the Rubik's Cube is 20, meaning that any configuration can be solved in 20 moves, at most 20 moves, and there are some configurations that do require 20 moves. That took an enormous amount of computational horsepower to use, and he was able to apply some of the same techniques here to bypass the requirement to keep all the points in memory at once. So I was only able to image things up to no more than a couple of billion points in any of the images. This fractal zoom that we were about to see from Tom was imaged to 2 trillion points. And there's no way we could keep all of that in memory, let alone the time cost of comparing against all of them. So we're going to zoom in on n equals 7 here. And we'll see that just like n equals 12, there's repeating structure. OK, there's one order that repeats, now it's repeating again, zoom in, it's repeating again, but wait, what's this thing here that looks like a spaceship? And that's breaking apart into other things. this just makes no sense. I mean, it's one thing to say we have a mystery of where does this recursive fractal structure come from, but we do see the fractals. But here we have a fractal that repeated its pattern exactly on three successively smaller scales. It completed the cycle, and then it did something different. So obviously there's some dynamics and some mechanism that causes patterns to be reproduced on smaller scales. We just don't understand it. But how can it possibly do that three times and then do something different? This is probably the biggest mystery that we have come across so far investigating these spaces. I will concede that it's conceivable this is due to numerical artifacts in coding, but we've done a lot of work to ensure that that's not the case, and we believe this is real. So this is a real mystery. Here's a short summary of the stuff that we have found numerically and otherwise in terms of numerics. We've actually characterized the critical radius numerically up to n equals 100, and also if the left disk and the right disk are different. So 3, 5, we know that critical radius. 17, 19, we know that critical radius. Only in four cases do we have a closed form representation of what that critical radius is, and there's not really a pattern except that 5 and 10 are related. They're both the roots of the same polynomial. And otherwise, you know, this is wide open space for mathematical research, is to try to understand where these critical radii come from and understand where the fractals come from. And I've done a little bit of work to try to characterize the fractal dimension in some cases as well. This is what the critical radius looks like. There's an alternation between the odd and the even values because, you know, like for n equals 10, you also get some n equals 5 effect that comes into it. Okay. I want to move on outside of the domain of two-disk compound symmetry groups now, which is what we've been talking about. But the notion of compound symmetry group is broader than that. We've just been looking at really sort of the simplest case. But even once we move up to three disks, Will Kretschmer, another current collaborator, discovered that here's a three-disk configuration where n equals 2. The disks only turn by 180 degrees, none of this five-fold or seven-fold. But this group is infinite, because with three disks, you can arrange it so that the difference between the centers is irrational. And that means that you're basically shuffling things around on the line by irrational amounts, and that, again, generates this infinite group. Staying with two things that we rotate, they don't have to be disks. They just have to have n-fold rotational symmetry. So we could look at what happens with pentagons that we rotate by 72 degrees. And that actually turns up a new kind of pattern that we don't see with just the disks. As we get close to the critical radius and start to create some structure, now we see that there's these snaky things in each pentagon that have rotational symmetry but not reflectional symmetry. The overall thing, you know, it's a chiral pattern. The overall thing is mirror symmetric. We never saw that with the disks, so this is interesting. And I just happened to notice today, wandering through the shop upstairs, there's this puzzle or math art thing designed by Edmund Harris, which has exactly the same pattern on the front. So that's just a curious coincidence. We can rotate an annulus instead of a disk. Eric has looked at that in a few cases. Here we have, I believe, n equals 12. So now we're rotating only the stuff that is within those regions and not the middles of the disks. And that generates different patterns. Here's one with n equals 5, where we have a disk on the left and a nullus on the right. Okay, but we're still just scratching the surface. We haven't even looked at translations or reflections. All we've done is rotations, but you know those wallpaper groups, they have translations and rotations and reflections. So we can imagine in the space of compound symmetry adding in, for example, translation of a half space or reflection of a half space and combining those together and combining those with rotations. So there's still a lot of fertile ground for exploration here, even within two dimensions. But really what's exciting is what happens when you move up to three dimensions. And we haven't really done anything there. We can imagine that we could do the same thing as we did with disks. We could say, oh, well, we've got two spheres and we're going to rotate each sphere according to some three-dimensional point group, like the icosahedral group or the octahedral group, and see what happens. And I expect and hope that we'll find cool new 3D fractals that I can 3D print. But even though we haven't done that, I can say that part of the motivation for the very notion of compound symmetry group does come from a very particular 3D case that I want to share with you. So let's just look at very simple 3D ordinary symmetry groups, in this case point groups, like the symmetry group of the icosahedron. Icosahedron has 20 sides, so we can put one of 20 on top and rotate that triangle one of three ways. So there's 60 possible orientations, 60 elements of the rotational icosahedral group. Very simple 3D symmetry group. That group can be generated by only two rotations, one triangular rotation like this and one twofold rotation about the center of an edge like that. Those will combine to generate the entire symmetry group of the icosahedron. Okay, and similarly, the cube has 24 possible orientations. Six faces can go on top and you can turn it four ways, and you can generate that group. That group is actually called the octahedral group, even though it's a cube, because the cube and the octahedron have the same symmetries. So we can generate the octahedral group by two rotations, again, just rotation by 90 degrees about, say, the x-axis and the y-axis. And by combining those, we can generate all 24 of the possible orientations of the cube. All right, those are some simple 3D symmetry groups. What's the simplest possible 3D compound symmetry group that you can imagine? You want to add in an isometry that is not of the entire space. So the simplest thing would probably be to add in a rotation of a half space. So let's try that. Let's stick with the octahedral group, where we have this 90-degree rotation and this 90-degree rotation. Let's add in rotation of a half space, say about the z-axis, and we're going to offset it slightly from the xy plane. All right, so a rotation of a half space, just like in the disk compound symmetry groups that we saw, chop space into pieces. So we're actually going to be turning, you know, a layer here. And wait a minute. What do you know? We have an isometry that does this. We have an isometry that, the other two isometries let us put any face we want on top of the cube, and this third isometry lets us rotate this top layer. So it turns out that pretty much the simplest 3D compound symmetry group that you can imagine is the Rubik's Cube group. That means that the Rubik's Cube is actually as pure and simple and elegant a mathematical object as the icosahedral group that's been known about for centuries. It's just that nobody ever thought to characterize the Rubik's Cube as a symmetry group before, because the concept of compound symmetry group was not out there. So I'm really excited about this, both because it, to me, elevates the Rubik's Cube to where, you know, this platonic, pure mathematical space to where it belongs rather than just a toy. But also because it highlights that the concept of compound symmetry group is new and useful and has all these unexplored spaces where people have characterized all the wallpaper groups and all these other symmetry group families. Nobody has looked at the space of these, you know, for example, these 3D symmetry groups that are like the Rubik's Cube group. You can get, you know, the tetrahedron, the icosahedron, and hundreds of twisty puzzles that are examples of simple 3D compound symmetry groups. That's a family that has yet to be explored and mapped, just as we have just started to explore and map the 2D circle puzzles. So if you look, you know, Rubik's Cube is often used to teach group theory. And the problem is that the way that it's defined, you know, so the Rubik's Cube has 54 little stickers on it. Those are facets. And every time you turn a face, it permutes some of those facets. And that's the way the group is normally defined, is a set of six permutations of the 48 non-center facets of a Rubik's Cube. But that's just this sort of arbitrary thing. No, the Rubik's Cube is a compound symmetry group defined by two full rotations and one half space rotation, and that gives you exactly the same mathematical structure, but it's, in this case, a pure geometric object. Okay, winding down the actual talk now, there's a hands-on activity after the talk, I'll just share some final artwork with you. This one I like quite a lot. This comes from, again, a combination of threefold and fivefold symmetry. And I've chosen a particular color palette and mapping from the space to the color palette to get this effect. And so the way that this works is you know, the compound symmetry group chops space into pieces, and each of those pieces, like this piece here, could also go here, could also go here, could also go here. It has an order, which is the number of places that it occurs in the entire image. And so what we're doing is we're mapping the order of each piece to color according to some particular rule. And we can play with that rule and play with the color palette, and that brings out and highlights different elements of the structure of the space that we're looking at, or gives different artistic effects. To me, this reminds me of Kandinsky, so I like this one quite a lot. Here's an example based on n equals fivefold plus fourfold symmetry. This is 13-fold symmetry. I like this palette. It looks sort of dark and dangerous, maybe. I've got a few more movies. The movies take a lot of computation to generate. This is n equals 9, and we're going to asymptotically approach the critical radius, and that's where all the structure happens, is as you get close to the critical radius. You just get this explosion of fireworks here going on. So that's n equals 9. This is n equals 7, and I'm not zooming in, but just sitting on top of where the characteristic n equals 7 fractal motif gets created. This is what you saw in the n equals 7 fractal that we saw earlier. Here is fivefold plus fourfold, and this is what's on my shirt, slightly different color palette. We'll go through that space here shortly. Right around there is what's on my shirt. And you keep going right up next to the critical radius, and you just get infinitely richer and more structure. So we're right on the edge of the fractal boundary there. And that is my last slide. There is a hands-on activity that I will get to. But in the meantime, here's a couple of QR codes you might want. There's a paper that describes all this theory in more detail. And a link to the app that you now are going to be able to play with on your iPads. And so I will demo the app and also take questions while that's going on. Also, I want to say I have high-quality printouts of a lot of images from these slides that are available up front. There's some 8.5 by 11s. There's not enough 8.5 11s. For everyone, there's also some 4x6s. Everyone should be able to take something. So I hope you take those home and enjoy them. All right, let me describe this app to you. Some of you may already have been playing with it. Here we go. All right, so you all should have an iPad running this app. And I should say this app was written, the guts were written by Tom Rokicki, and the interface mostly by Eric Virgo, who is also here. And thank you very much to Tom and Eric for turning this toy into something that is really a valuable exploration tool at this point and really fun. Last few days, as we were getting ready for the talk, I couldn't stop playing with this. So you can, the basic way that this works is, if I can get my mouse cursor over here, if you tap the screen, you get controls. So these controls at the bottom, any compound symmetry group is going to be characterized by the N, that's the rotational symmetry of the left disk and also of the right disk, so N1 and N2 and R1 and R2. And you can select any of those things here and use a slider to play with the parameters, and the program will render that in not quite real time, but pretty good. R will change R1 and R2 together, N will change N1 and N2 together. The die will randomize the configuration. A fun thing to do is to randomize the configuration and go over to this menu and say snap to critical radius, because all the interesting structure is right below the critical radius. And then we can, for example, zoom in and pan around and start to see what some of the structure looks like. Now, if you go well past the critical radius, as I'll do here, it just fills up with gray fractal dust that the program can't render. It cuts off each point at 100,000 images to make it responsive and live. So what you can do, the program will snap to the critical radius, but that's setting R1 and R2 to be equal, because that's what we have the data for. However, you can explore this further by saying, well, I'm going to make R1 smaller and now I can play with a given play with R2 until I find where the dust starts to form. There's also interesting patterns in the dust, as we saw with the quasicrystals earlier. So you can just sort of surf around these spaces. You can make your own math artwork. You can change the color palette. You can, if you want to save one of your images, you can use the share button in the URL bar to airdrop to your phone. There's also a command here to download the image. That will save it to the Files app on the iPad, which if you know how to use that, you could go to and again use AirDrop. A couple other things here. We can image the entire disk, so we can image only the boundary. This is sort of interesting for when we want to see what the fractals look like. So let's say set n equals, hard for me to see, is that n equals 5? Yeah, and then snap to the critical radius. I left it in generator mode. Okay, here's full symmetry mode. So there is sort of what the n equals 5 fractal looks like. And you can also go and choose, so this is showing the full, what we call the full unbandaging, the image under both group generators. If we say simulate single generator, then what we're doing is just turn one disk, turn the other disk, turn one disk, turn the other disk, and that reveals different kinds of structure. And in this case, you can go well beyond the critical radius and still see a lot of structure. So have fun playing with this, and you'll have, 10 or 15 minutes or so to do that. And while that's going on, I'll go back to my slides and take questions, and people are also welcome to come up and take some of the artwork. So, thank you.
And if anybody has a question, you can raise your hand. I will bring you the microphone.
So you mentioned you can find darts and kites with this.
Yeah.
Have you found other things, you know, other kinds of darts and kites or 3D kind of darts?
No, it's and honestly, that was a fortuitous find, that slide that I showed. You can sort of see, anytime you image that fractal dust, you can sort of see patterns, but seeing them that clearly is rare. And it sort of depends on the particular rendering parameters that you've set. There are analogs for other N of Penrose tiles. We haven't made a systematic search, but I would not be surprised to find them in there.
Going back to the simple case of just rotating two disks,
mm-hmm.
Could you give any more intuition for why there is a critical radius? Why the thing is finite before, infinite there, and then not well-defined after?
Yeah. So if we think about the n equals 5 case, say, then if we scale the radius up to infinity, imagine that we have two centers of fivefold rotation. Okay, then we can like take one of them and rotate it by this amount, take another one and rotate it by this amount, and if you keep applying those rotations iteratively and map out where the points go, effectively you're creating a lattice, but the crystallographic restriction theorem says such a lattice cannot exist. And it's actually not too hard to prove. I don't have a slide in here, but what you can do is the following. You can generate, imagine that you're considering points, the radius is large enough so that all the points are moved by both disks, okay? You can, if you start with one point, you can image a pentagon around the other point. Now, that pentagon, if you look at the distance from the origin to each pentagon, for the pentagon it works the other way. Yeah, if you look at the edges of each pentagon, okay, that's a set of vectors that are translations, and you can generate those translations by pairs of rotations. You can combine those into a pentagram, and that pentagram has is a border that is a pentagon that is smaller than the original pentagon. So what you've done is use these rotations to generate a set of translations that's smaller than the translations you started with, and you can iterate that and shrink that smaller pentagon farther. So you can generate arbitrarily small translations, which means the group is infinite.
Hi, thanks for the talk. So since these beautiful works of math and art were inspired by a puzzle of gears,
mm-hmm.
Do you now see gears in a different light? This math, you know, shows computational irreducibility. And you may recall that the first computer was made out of gears. It was Babbage's and Lovelace's computer. So, so did your mind go back to gears after
that's
this?
That's a neat connection. And it's true that this puzzle has gears. I mean, it's just sort of an implementation detail that it's made of gears. So I haven't been thinking a lot about gears. I will say that when I first discovered that these things were infinite, which nobody expected, the first time that happened was for n equals 7. And one of the first fractal images that came up of n equals 7 that showed those sort of circular cutout holes, it had gear teeth. So I could look at it and say, there's gears right inside this puzzle. So that was just sort of serendipitous, but not especially really interesting, I think, just sort of amusing.
Actually, I have a question related to the toy. The person, do you know who made, who created the toy, and were they alive to know that they had approached a mathematical horizon?
Gizmo gears?
Yeah.
Doug Engel. I'm sorry if I've neglected to mention that during the talk, because Doug is should certainly be credited.
Maybe you did.
No, maybe I did the first talk. I might not have this time. Doug Engel is responsible for gizmo gears, and more than that, he has written two books about circle puzzles, a circle puzzle manual, part one and part two. And was very prescient about a lot of what was going to happen in the world of twisty puzzles much later from when he wrote all of that. So Doug has been following this thread on the Twisty Forum and is very excited to see this work actually come out to the public now. Yeah.
Any other questions? Yes.
Thanks for the talk, very interesting talk. So if you have just one disk that's just a symmetry group, are there any fractal shapes that you could make out of that or no?
No, it all comes from the interaction. And I should say, I wanted to make this little philosophical aside during the talk, and I kind of spaced out doing that. A circle, the symmetries of a circle under infold rotation are not very interesting. It has a certain behavior, it has a certain set of patterns. You take another circle that's the same, you put them together and interesting stuff happens. And I've actually, maybe it's just me and maybe I'm weird, I have this metaphor in my mind for life in terms of that. Any one person has their own internal behaviors and their own patterns, and another person has their own behaviors and their own patterns that are going to be whatever they are, but you put them together and you get this whole new richness and structure that didn't exist on its own until you put those people together. And it's the same way with the disks. You don't get any of the fractals until you get this interaction.
All right, well, let's give another hand to our speaker.